morning.
I want to
welcome everybody. Glad you're here. I had two things I wanted to talk about briefly, and then I'll introduce our moderator. The first one has to do with, if you've noticed in the paper this week, that Mike Egan passed away. And Mike Egan, I used to work for Mike Egan. I was the legal aide to the minority leader in the Georgia House of Representatives. The minority leader isn't what you think it is. The minority leader is politically who's not in power. And the Republicans back in the early 70s when I was the legal aide were clearly not in power. I did that for 2 years. The first one was with Carr Dotson, who was the state representative from Macon, and he chose not to run for re-election. And they had a contest to succeed him as minority leader, and the election was between Mike Egan and Dick Lane, who was a state representative from East Point, who later switched to the Democratic Party, and Mike Egan won. Then after that, Mike was a state representative for a while. When Jimmy Carter became elected president and Griffin Bell was appointed as Attorney General, he took Mike Egan up to Washington. He was an assistant Attorney General, and then he came back to Atlanta. Mike lived near Piedmont Hospital, and he ran for the state senate. He was a Republican state senator for a number of years, and a very well-respected individual, and he passed away this week. The second thing I want to talk about is dysfunction. I don't want Tom to raise his hand. Is there anybody here who's dysfunctional?
There are people here.
We actually are. Well, I want to just sort of tell you where that's coming from, although you may have read about it. You've got to go back in time. In 1968, Jim Tysinger was running for the state senate. Bob Bell was running for state representative. A couple of other people were running for office. And they decided that it would be good to have a forum where they could meet with citizens. And if they got elected, as elected officials, they could meet with citizens. And of course, these people got elected. And so this breakfast forum began in 1968, actually before the election. They were elected in 68 and took office in January 69. Jim Tysinger ran this forum until after he retired as a state senator, and he was a senator for over 30 years. And then he still ran it until he wasn't physically able to, and he found a much younger person to run it, and we've been going on from there. But when he set it up, the judiciary was partisan, the school board was partisan, and he decided, well, you know, I'm going to be an elected official for the citizens. I don't think we ought to have this as a partisan organization. We should not be an arm of the Republican Party, although the people who started this were all Republicans. So it was started in a nonpartisan effort, and it was never part of the Republican Party. The Constitution was changed in the early 80s of Georgia, and the judiciary became nonpartisan, with the exception of the magistrate court. And the judges are nonpartisan. And at some time a little after that, the school board became nonpartisan. And that gave judges and candidates for judge, and school board members and candidates of school board a place to go that they didn't feel like they were violating anything by going to anything on a partisan basis. And it's worked out very well. We ended up maybe confusing things because we used to have breakfast at a bunch of restaurants on Saturday morning. And we'd go to a particular place and like, for example, we went to right down the block over here at 285, the hotel over there, and we were there, and you go to the manager and say, we'd like to bring in 30 or 40 people every Saturday morning, and they're looking at dollar signs, and they'd go ahead and they'd let us go in there, and then people like myself would come along, and I'd get a cup of coffee, and then I'd get another cup of coffee, and then I might get a third cup of coffee, and very few people ate breakfast, and they really didn't make any money. So they would sort of reluctantly, because this guy was a state senator, they would kick us out. And this is just not working out. So we'd leave and go someplace else. And then we actually went back to that hotel twice because they changed management. They never knew that we were kicked out one time. But that's just the way it works. Well, maybe 25 years ago, the Republican Party had their office in downtown Decatur and decided they wanted to move to downtown Decatur to someplace a little further on the north side. And they ended up at Embry Hills, which everybody's familiar with. But they didn't have enough money to pay for the rent. And we, meanwhile, had been kicked out of so many places so many times, we were looking for something a little bit more permanency. So we ended up making an arrangement with them that if they would go ahead and get the office, it would be their office, but we would put, we would pay part of the rent, and we would only use it 2 hours a week. And it was theirs the rest of the time. And that worked out until they moved their office. And when they moved their office and then actually at one point moved it to Dunwoody and then later closed it, although they reopened, we've been here and it's worked out very well. So where does that come to dysfunctional? Well, the article in the paper this week about the dysfunction of the Republican Party, whatever you think about that, put down at the last paragraph something to the effect that when the Republicans meet at their breakfast on Saturday, Panera, hold down the seat, so I'm holding my seat, but it's a misnomer because this is not the Republican Party of DeKalb County. This is the Tysinger Breakfast Forum, a nonpartisan group, places where we can hear from the judge, our probate judge or anything else, and anybody can come here and we can have that opportunity to have discussion. We've had various people who've come here who are blatant Democrats, run his office as Democrat, and they're welcome as anybody else is. So I want to welcome everybody to the Tysinger Breakfast Forum, our moderator, Bob Dallas.
My historical perspective, Stanley's still alive, unlike Mikey, who was a great senator. I got to know him when he was there, when it was the minority party. And it was interesting because you had Senator Tysinger, you had Senator Coverdale. I mean, some of the people that we look to today, still say with a lot of respect, and perhaps if we ask the question, how should we, for those who are in office, serve, I would point to those people as setting a very good example of maintaining principles, but working towards goals that serve citizens. Well, as we know, we've heard Stanley's historical perspective, so yes, this is not the DeKalb Republican Party. That's important to know. And as Stanley mentioned, you know, DeKalb County, it's important for us who care about DeKalb County to have all the policymakers come here and share their thoughts, engage, and have a conversation. And we've reached out to them irrespective of party affiliation or not. And so keep that in mind that when we ask CEO candidates, sheriff's candidates, the prosecutorial candidates to come here, it's really to find out their perspective on how this county should be run. Because as we know, there's a lot of questions about how the county is being operated, and it's up to us to listen, learn, share ideas, but more importantly, I think more than anything else, because you are an engaged group, talk to people back home. The more you do that, then the better the citizens out there will be. But let's face it, you know, if they read the paper, that's what they know, which, you know, we'll get this perhaps biased there or not. If they just read blogs, then that's what they know. And I dare say if you read blogs, there's a bias out there. So here's a way for us to talk directly with our candidates and policymakers of this county. And there's always something for us to talk about as we have good, bad, or ugly sometimes. But having said that, one of the traditions that we have is that when we have judicial candidates and the judiciary here, they always get to go first. We always get to jump to the front of the line. And we have one of our great probate judge, not one of, the great probate judge, in DeKalb County. Here with us, and comes here periodically, Judge Rosh, if you want to come up and give her a hand.
You're not going to throw a review of papers, Bob.
So. Well, if you pop up, we're all going to end up in her court, whether you like it or not. Some sooner than later. But having said that, you can rest assured eternally, knowing that your estate will be taken care of as it should under Georgia law.
That's right.
Thank you, Judge.
Well, good morning. Things are plugging along as usual. Let me get this out of the way. If anyone asks you if I'm running or not, I think you start getting a little older and the vultures are out there. And everyone's asking if you're running. I am, and will qualify the first week of March and run in May. I'll talk a little bit about the weapons carry license because of the fact that It's in the paper everywhere, and everyone is either complaining because it takes too long or whatever. We are doing our best. We issued last year, I don't want to give the exact number, but approximately over 7,000, perhaps 7,500 was my last count. That last year was about 5,000. Same staff, less, the space seems to be getting worse. I've asked for more space, but as Bob said, because of all the misspending that has gone on in the county, it's difficult to get money for anything. But it's very frustrating because who's been down in that department lately? Has anyone been down in the marriage or weapon carry? It's unacceptable. It is unacceptable. And when I say unacceptable, I don't get anything off of this. I'm two floors up where we have ample space. But I'm talking about for the taxpaying citizens and for my staff. There's nowhere for someone to sit. It is total chaos. The line, if you know the downstairs, wraps around outside down to the break room. So it's very frustrating. I'm working on it. Supposedly I'm going to get the money, but I don't know if it'll be in my lifetime. That's how things move. It is taking right now. What's really frustrating is on the other side of the wall, an empty break room. And that's the space that I'm trying to get to break in. I don't want to take the whole break room away because that never knows, it'll cause something. But there's ample room to break through and enlarge this space. Everybody laughs about the weapon carry license being in the same place as the marriage, but that is what's happening, and it's just ridiculously crowded. So with that said, I'll get off that bandwagon. It is taking about 8 to 12 weeks to get your carry permit. I do my best because what happens is on the first go round, after you've gone to get fingerprinted, I get the stack of records back. And it is a very complicated procedure. And you want me to be sifting through those records. I'm not going to give a license to someone until I have done that. And it is extremely complicated. When I go through it the first time, let's just say someone has a simple assault charge. It doesn't tell me, and they've been charged with it. It does not tell me if that is of domestic violence. And if you've got any record of domestic violence right now, you are not going to get a weapon permit. It's as simple as that. So I have to then put it on the applicant, send me an incident report so that we can go through the incident report. But even the definition is not simple. I couldn't even tell you the definition right now of who would qualify as being domestic violence.
What if there's a juvenile person comes in later on when they had a juvenile offense and the records were sealed for Captain Jim?
I don't know, because I haven't had that. Yeah, I haven't had that, or I wouldn't
know.
Exactly. So it just takes, you've got out-of-state charges. They may not be called the same thing in each state. They may not carry the same penalty. So it is very, very time-consuming. And I have a clerk who is very, very good, but at the same time, I've got to go behind her, and I've got to be checking all these things. Then we get it back from the documents back. We do have a much better system in place. I have very few appeals, which is surprising, on denials. I really have very few. I have a lot of people want to come in and discuss it. I had someone last week who's very unhappy. He had two misdemeanor drug charges back in the 80s, and I can understand how he feels. But that's what the law says. It's not written clearly. He felt that if you were clean for 5 years, that he would be able to get the chart, that he would be able to get his permit. But the 5 years only applies if you have one drug charge, misdemeanor or not. Now, felony you can forget, but misdemeanor. Do I think that's right? Probably not. But I can't do anything. I did go so far to get the county attorney involved because the law was not written very clearly, and he affirmed what I thought, and that it's a denial. So it's very complicated. We're doing our best. I'm trying to get space. All of these things would help. I can't get another clerk. I have nowhere to put her. Actually, I have a clerk right now who does not have a desk because of the space. So anyway, be patient. I'm doing my best to do that along with all the other things. Guardianships are at an increase. People are aging. There's just people outliving their money. And what can I say?
Hey, Judge, I want to say publicly, you do an outstanding job. I've known you for a long time. Every time I've come, you are probably one of the most advanced, professional public servants that we have, and you don't sugarcoat anything, and that's what I appreciate. You're transparent, you have an open door, and I appreciate that.
Thank you.
And I'd be glad to be a volunteer clerk for you. I'll be glad to. I don't have nothing to do, I'm retired. I'm good.
Anybody have any questions?
The renewals for the weapons permit process exactly the same as the first
one? No fingerprints.
Okay, so
yeah, for a while they were interpreting that you had to do fingerprints again, but no.
So just go in your office, you don't have to go to the county.
Still run your background check, of course.
But it's all
because heaven knows what you may have done during this 5-year period, right?
Heaven may know in other people.
Yeah. Is it GPI or FBI?
Both.
And if you're not on there, then you're clean.
Except mental health. Yeah, we have to run that.
Yeah.
Have you seen the gun carry permit process become more complicated, significant in the last year, two, three?
I think what has happened is when we know that sometimes you can take that permit that we're issuing and go and purchase a gun, and they're relying on your checks based on that permit, we take it more seriously, okay? And I think that is what has happened more than anything else. Everybody wants to protect themselves. And I think the publicity of all of this, combined with the fact that you can't take that permit and buy a gun with, from what I understand, I don't know this, but you can buy it, there's no waiting period, and there's no checks being done. So if they can buy it based on that, yeah.
Where is the permit list here? Is that a local entity, or do y'all turn that in to the feds? Is it a national list?
Both.
Okay.
Have a great day.
The interesting thing, you go to South Carolina, you can buy a long rifle, but you can't buy a sidearm in South Carolina. I just asked that. I was over there doing it. You can't go. But an interesting thing, I'm adding to it, Judge. Up in Tennessee, I don't know if they want to do it here, but they put you, if you have a gun carry permit, they put it on your driver's license to help the police, you know, when they stop you. You know, as responsible gun owners, you're going to cooperate and stuff. But what, you think that's a good idea or a bad idea, putting you on your driver's license?
Is that legislatively done?
And probably so, but I mean, they do it in Tennessee, which really helps police officers out for protection.
No, I understand that. You know, legislative question like that, the judge would applies the law.
Yeah.
We'll have to ask our next representative candidate that very question.
Yeah.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. For those of you who drive like your shoot, or shoot like you drive, which is a very scary thing, we do have one of our traffic division state court judges here. If you'd like to say a few words, come on up. I mean, there's so many things you can start off with, but first of all, as an attorney and somebody who's involved in traffic safety, I appreciate that we have this court. Four judges who are focused in on that, which is probably public safety issue number one. You know, by any measure, in terms of the number of injuries and deaths that occur, it occurs most on the roadway. Not intentionally, for the most part. I mean, 99% of the time, people don't go out there to kill somebody. However, their behavior results in that. So what we have is law enforcement out there enforcing our laws. And I know some people think, well, they just have to get me to raise revenue and all these other kinds of crazy things. But the fact of the matter is, if you didn't have that enforcement, whatever it is today would be significantly worse. I can without doubt tell you that. So having said that, having a professional class of judges, as we do, is a great thing. So Judge Story is here to, I guess, hopefully tell us a little bit about it. And I understand that you guys are focusing on a new teen program.
Oh yes, I'd
be interested in hearing about, because that's a novel thing too, which is another good outcome from having a professional court. So thank you, Judge. Give her a hand.
Good morning, everyone, and Happy New Year. I think the last time that I was with you all was when we did the, I think we did the joint program with this group and Stan Watson's group back in November. So I haven't seen you since the new year. I hope the new year is starting great for everyone. I am Judge Keisha Story. I'm one of the judges in the DeKalb State Court Traffic Division. Good to see you also, Judge Rosh. I am in Division A. And again, I'm happy to be here. Things, I think the first time I ever came to address this group, I was about 2 weeks in. And now I'm 5 months in, so a lot has changed. That's right. A lot has happened since then, and you know, we are getting a lot more comfortable and things are going well. I did update you all the last time I was here about some of the initiatives that we have, which is the deferred sentencing program, which a lot of people were interested in, that gives folks more time to pay when they come in. If they don't have their fine that day, they'll have a period of time without having to go on probation and incurring other fees to pay their fine. Usually 6 weeks, sometimes we do it as long as 8 weeks, and that's working well. People actually come back in 6 to 8 weeks and they pay their fine, and that helps them out without having to, like I said, incur those extra probation fees. One of the things that this group asked me about the last time I was here was about more education generally to the public about traffic safety and traffic laws, because you were concerned that some people drive on the roads and they don't know that they're committing traffic offenses. They don't know that what they're doing is wrong until they get pulled over and get a ticket. One of the things that we're doing, and Bob alluded to, was focusing more on teens and the teen drivers. And one of the partnerships that we are trying to create is the Teen Victim Impact Panel. And that involves an organization that does focus on teen risky driving behaviors, the texting while driving, the distracted driving, the having too many other teens in the car while they're driving, and that causes a distraction, the radio, and all of the things that teens do that causes them to get into horrible accidents. We are trying to bring in a program that takes some partnerships and some consensus building, which we've laid a good foundational groundwork for, and I believe that that will hopefully take place within the next several months. So I hope to be able to come back and update you all about where we are on that in the next several months. Of course, you know, 2016 is a big election year, so I think I am pretty sure that some of the partnerships that we need to create to make sure that that program gets off the ground will probably take place sometime after that in the next several months. So that's where we are. I know a lot of people always ask me, like, well, what are some of the funny things you hear? You know, I bet you hear a lot of funny things in traffic court. And it's true, we hear a lot of funny things, but you know, one of the biggest things that I'm seeing right now is the big impact that we are, and me personally, it's important to me that I'm able to make. You know, and some things that seem to be funny to some people aren't so funny to the person that's experiencing it. I had a person that was driving a very slow vehicle, a moped, that was just a hair faster than a bicycle on 78. And the reason he was driving that vehicle was because that was the only vehicle his family had. And he lived in Snellville and was coming into DeKalb County every day to Pepsi to work. And that was the only way he could get back and forth. You know, so should he have had it on 78 in rush hour traffic? No. But that was the only way that he could get around with for his family and make a living. So it's funny on the outset, but when you really start delving into some of these issues, it's not so funny. And, you know, I'm fortunate to be on the bench and have the life experience that I have and the legal experience that I have and the compassion, honestly, that I have, that I can address those issues and try to help those individuals problem solve. So I'm fortunate, I'm blessed, and I am happy to be here with you this morning. Any questions anyone has, I'll be happy to answer.
What is the status of driver education in high schools? Is there any going on?
I don't believe that there is much going on in DeKalb County. Bob may be able to fill us in a little bit more on that.
DeKalb County, I don't believe, maintains its driver's ed.
No.
But, because I remember when I was highway safety director, we took all this equipment and get it out.
That's a big mistake not to have it.
Well, here's the thing. Driver's ed. All right, first, I'm a believer in driver's ed. So put that on the table. I think it's an important part of anybody getting out there on the roadway. But the question is, when you look at the data, does the person who has driver's ed, does their outcome differ from the person who does not? And what we're looking at is crash outcome. There have been many studies done that have concluded not by much. Now, the studies, you know, actually the first major study that came to that conclusion was done here in DeKalb County with its very comprehensive program of driver's ed. And they set up a comprehensive program, a less comprehensive program, and no program. And they studied over several years, spent a lot of money, but these things are expensive to do, and came to the conclusion there wasn't much difference. So there have been studies after studies, looking at the old studies and new studies, and try to assess whether or not things have changed. But we've had technological changes. For example, the simulators today are significantly better than they were perhaps 90 years ago. And so does that change anything? Well, here's the long and the short of it. What has changed the outcomes? First, the teen driving laws have had a significant impact on that. The graduated licensing program that says you can get your learner's permit, you have to have 40 hours of drive time, and you have to have driver's ed in Georgia at least if you want to be able to get your restricted license at 16. Now, when you get that restricted license at 16, you get 6 months of very strong restrictions that will limit a lot of things that you do, including what the judge mentioned, distractions of other passengers in a car who are not related to you. And then from that point, after you graduate the 6 months, before you get your unrestricted license, you still are restricted in things that you can do. That has an impact on the outcome. States who have those laws versus those who have not have seen differences. And when the laws are implemented, they've seen reductions in teen driver deaths. So that's a good thing. The second thing that's critical is a parental involvement in that teen's use of the vehicle. Because obviously the parent owns a car. Because you can't buy a car under 18 years of age. You're not legally allowed to. That being the case, then what are the things that the parent can do? Well, enforce not only the laws of the state, but impose additional rules of the family that says, no, I'm not going to let you do that. You can't do that. This is that. This is that. In other words, box the teen in absolutely as much as possible, and over a period of time, perhaps demonstrate responsibility and other outcomes. So those two things have helped. So driver's ed versus that. So you can imagine school systems throughout the country, when they learn that driver's ed doesn't produce an outcome that changes results, these things start to evaporate like crazy. Why? Extremely expensive. We have, you know, teachers that are qualified to do this, a lot of space to do it, you know, for the driving program, and you have to have vehicles in which to drive with the kids. And they have insurance questions. And it takes a lot of time.
So you're saying there's very little difference statistically between those who have had driver ed and those who haven't?
Yes.
Shocking.
It is. And I could point to other country systems, which are much more comprehensive. I mean, you know, a couple of years of things, instead of 40 hours, you may have several hundred hours, which I highly recommend, by the way. And all those things have produced better outcomes. And they have enforcement laws that we do not have. We don't allow random stops in Georgia.
Right.
I mean, we can have road checks, that's about it. But you just cannot randomly stop people because of our Constitution. They don't have that in Georgia. Automated enforcement. You know, we have a little bit of that with red light cameras, but that's it. Over there in European countries, you have a lot of automated enforcement. It goes well beyond what we have with not only red light cameras, but speed enforcement, pervasively. And so when we hear about the Autobahn being unlimited speed limits, it's relatively a short distance. And when they impose the speed limit, those speed limits tend to be lower than ours. And they're automatically enforced with random stops. So you get a lot of things taken care of, like DUIs or impaired due to drugs. So you get that. So there are a lot of things that are going on in a teen driving context. So all of us ask the question, what's the right thing to do? Limited resources, you want the best outcome. So the tendency is to focus on good drivers, graduated licensing law, GDL laws, and getting that parent more engaged. I suspect the program that you're looking at is how many hours? 14?
Only about 4 to 6 hours.
Okay.
It's a day-long program.
Well, I mean, if you're engaging a person at that point, my only advice would be for these teens is drag that parent in.
And the parents can contribute to the program.
That's a key part of it. There are several programs out there that I'm aware of that involve the team in here that have shown good outcomes that have been looked at by the experts. Yeah, and then John, I guess.
Back in the 1800s when I got my driver's license, I had to read a book. And you said something about that that they didn't even know they were breaking the law. Isn't everybody supposedly supposed to read a book still, or something online, or something off a tree, or something? I mean, please.
Absolutely, they still have to do that, and that's why I'm glad you brought that up, because that's another thing I see. I see people that are charged with driving without a license, and when I ask them, I inquire, well, why don't you have your license, and why do you continue to drive? They can't pass the test. You know, and so there are a lot of literacy issues right now. They can drive, they can read signs, but they can't read that book, you know, comprehensively enough to pass the test. And they can only take it, I think, once a week. So I had a person that had come, that had gone 15, I think, consecutive Mondays, literally 15, and could not pass the test.
So what I did was, or Atlanta public school system.
I'm not sure what school system it was, but I did refer her to one of the public defenders that said that he or she, I can't remember, had a resource that could help those drivers that were having trouble just comprehending the book. But that book is still required, test is still required.
It is. It's a Department of Driver Services book. You can either read it online or get it online. Secondly, they have a teen parent guide. It's a comprehensive guide available to be printed online that goes through from the, you know, here's what the basics are, all the way down to the complicated things that you should know by the time that you get your restricted license. That's a very good book. I mean, it took a lot of effort by the Department of Driver Services to put that together with the teen driver commission, which Georgia has, that looks at all this on a comprehensive basis. Let me just say, Georgia has, if you want to get driver's ed for your kid, is available either through the private side, but Georgia has programs out there that are subsidized so you can get it. I mean, I know the state puts that together. There's the client add-ons that come from Joshua's Law that created a lot of our teen driving laws, help to fund those. So it's available. Now, you know, I would never send a kid out without driver's ed, even though the study's actually evidence. John had a question.
Yes, my question was, what's the status of adult driver education?
We always want to fix the teen, but you know, they did us.
Can I follow up with that, because that's what my question was.
Oh, sorry,
that's okay, but we are, because people will bring guardianship petitions, and they're bringing them in because their elderly parent wants to take the car out. I mean, there's other reasons, but that's a main factor, and can be very dangerous. Have you seen, and Bob, you may want to jump in too, but have you seen anyone coming in that you doubted their capacity to drive? And what do you do under those circumstances? And from what I understand, guardianship does not take the license away from someone. They have to go to the Department of Motor Vehicle. What happens at that point, Robert?
There's a referral process, and you know, I guess somebody close to the driver to refer. Doctors have the ability to refer as well, and you know, given the closeness of many doctors to those who may otherwise not be qualified, you know, they should refer that person and let DDS make an assessment as to whether or not that individual is qualified. My observation is that's not used very often. The numbers of assessments and forms that are sent in are nowhere near what you know the aging population is. So if you got this much of an aging population, this is what you'll see out there.
Are there other states that do require something more than we do as someone?
I cannot answer. Let me look at that. Okay. To let you know, on March 31st, at the Shepherd Center, there will be put on a program that involves the Highway Safety Office and other partners that is doing something interesting. It's taking the elderly driving questions and the teen driving questions and bringing them together, because there's apparently a fair amount of overlap, and what the goal is to try to use the limited resources to get good programs and policies in place to address some of those concerns.
And you said you have seen
It's rare. Thankfully, we have the Solicitor Generals that are in the courtroom, the prosecutors. Sherry Boston has a good group, a team of individuals, and they usually pre-try those cases first. And that elderly person normally comes up with a family member. They pre-try those cases. Sometimes they submit null process with some assurances that, you know, this license issue's been taken care of. And a lot of times, I don't even see them. I'll see that it's happening. But they won't come before me unless I'm signing off on the null process, and I may ask the circumstances and find out that way.
Right, and I'm certainly not saying just simply because someone is elderly that right. their license should be taken away, but I get really nervous in the courtroom when they don't know their name and they're driving an automobile.
Right, right.
It's a little nerve-wracking.
I'm more interested in what happens to my license. Carry a gun.
You don't need to drive straight, just shoot straight, right?
Yeah. I got a question. When you were talking about all those people that failed the test, how many of them were illegal aliens?
No, none of them were not or undocumented. None of them that I've encountered at this point
have been. They're the ones that don't have a license.
A lot of times, the individuals that are not documented may not even be eligible to. Obtain
the
license.
Right. The qualifications to get a license wouldn't allow the person you're referring to even have a license. So that's it would never be a judge's question.
Right.
You have a question?
Yeah, it appears when you watch the nightly news that there's a high degree of combination accidents that involve commercial vehicles and private vehicles. What court handles that, particularly if there's a fatality or an out-of-state commercial vehicle?
If it's just a regular accident, it would come to my court. If there is a fatality involved, it will either go to the solicitor's office or the DA's office, depending on if it's a misdemeanor vehicular homicide or a felony vehicular homicide. The felony is going to involve usually DUI as an underlying or reckless driving as an underlying. But if it's just like, let's say, a failure to maintain lane that results in a fatality, then that would go to the Solicitor General's office as misdemeanor vehicular homicide. But regular wrecks that happen with commercial vehicles and regular vehicles, they come to my courtroom and I see them all the time. I see them.
What percentage is that?
I don't know the percentages. I do see them. I'm not saying I see a whole lot of them, but I do see them.
Seems to me there's a fair amount of confusion among drivers regarding passing or not passing a school bus. We see a lot of cases where they are passed against the law. Two lane versus interstate, for example. Can you clarify that a little bit?
We are seeing them a lot more, and I hear that other counties have the cameras now on the school bus itself,
Comp,
and they're catching
up.
And I think Wynette has
it. Wynette and Comp both have the cameras on the bus. Not every bus, but it's like the buses. Right. In general, all right, you can't pass a school bus unless you're dealing with a divided roadway and
like an interstate.
That's limited access road. So that's not going to happen there. But pick a roadway that has, you know, a median planter, like actually Dunwoody Road. Outside of 285, that would be a good example where if you're on the other side going in the opposite direction, you could pass it. If you're going in the same direction as the school bus, you can't pass it.
Right.
There ain't no rule that allows you to do that. So just stop.
But on a two lane, if you're going the opposite direction, you're supposed to stop.
Even if it's a four lane,
a lot of people don't think I understand that.
It'd be six lane and not divided.
It's not divided.
Not divided by something. An actual boulevard.
Right. Bob, what is Buford Highway?
It's a very dangerous road.
That's called OGD Trail.
Have you seen a lot of move-up?
It really does. And you know, the law is that you have to either move over if there is a clear lane of travel for you to move over, or really drastically slow down if you can't move over. If there's traffic, no one's saying you have to get in an accident to move over, but if you can't move over, you have to really drastically slow down. And so what I'm seeing is people not applying their brakes or slowing down and continuing at their same rate of travel, rate of speed, and passing when there's flashing lights on the side.
Did doesn't that, if you can, cause problems? I mean, because it's so subjective, you know, as far as if you can move over or not.
Oh.
Yeah.
Well, and it is, you know, and I've had maybe one trial. A lot of those cases end up resolving in a plea of some sort. I think I've had one trial in that case where an officer testified there was clearly a clear lane of traffic and he had a laser and clocked the person going at the speed limit, like they never slowed down. So,
what is the fine for that?
A typical fine for that, and it, what I'm seeing, is between $300 and $400.
Or fine for that charge. Plus administrative cost that on top
plus
of that.
Plus court costs, which are which amount to about 40% of the fine.
I think you mentioned simulators. Are simulators used any place in DeKalb County, for example? And where?
Driving schools.
I don't know that the school system has a program. The Highway Safety Office just awarded grants to several technical colleges to be able to provide driver's ed programs in those. I don't know if any of the DeKalb County-based technical colleges are doing that or not. But that, for example, is another program that's out there that's subsidized heavily, making it affordable. And the reason behind my understanding that they're doing that is there are parts of the state where two things are happening. One, you don't have a large population of teens, so a private sector person probably could not come in there. And secondly, even if they did, it's too expensive for them. So this is subsidized through the technical college process in order to provide driver's ed to teens. And not only here, where if you want driver's ed, you'll get it here. But some parts of the state is very difficult because you'll have to drive 30 miles to get there. And you know, that's always a hassle.
I do want to say, too, that if we do notice that someone has a need for driver improvement, we do send them to a Department of Driver Services approved driver improvement school.
The CAM Medical used to have a virtual driving. Yeah, and I can refer patients because the children and the parents would be getting into a little argument.
Right.
And
right.
That would solve it without me being involved.
There's a gentleman back here.
Do y'all have any red light cameras here in DeKalb County, and do y'all prosecute people out there?
I don't think that there's any left in DeKalb. We used to have, I know Decatur used to have one. I'm trying to think if any other.
There's one. My GPS says there's one at Claremont and Ponce de Leon, and I go by there every morning, but I don't see any kind of camera or anything on the pole.
Yeah, Ponce, I mean, it's Scott, well, yeah. That's where it used to be, that's Decatur.
Right.
That intersection is Decatur jurisdiction. That was one of the first ones installed in the state, and my understanding it is, well, when I go by there, it's gone. So your GPS or whatever is telling you, you know, based on old information. But go ahead and stop still. My advice, you might have an officer there looking at you. That's right.
Judge, what are your ideas on preventing texting and driving?
That's hard because everyone has a smartphone and everyone is always on their smartphone and looking down at it. I've had a few cases that actually went to trial and a person said, I was texting, but I was at a red light. I was stopped, and that's still in violation of the law. You can't text and drive. You know, my ideas about how to prevent it, I'll have to think about that. I'll have to think about that and bring that back to this group.
You know what's sad about that? Even the police do it too when they drive.
They're allowed to
drive. That's not a good example.
The law allows them, and I'm going to jump in and, you know, I don't apologize for being supportive of them. Yes, they're allowed to, and there are a couple reasons. One, your officers have had EVOC training, emergency vehicle operation and control. That, you know, they've had a lot of hours where they have been trained to do certain things that you might not have that training for. And what's important about that is it's refreshed, and they engage that kind of stuff on a regular basis. So that's the first thing. And so they're excluded from the law in contrast to the rest of us who the law applies to. And the judge is exactly right. It doesn't matter if you're at a stop sign, red light, or not. If you're on a public way, you're not supposed to be using it. Now, there are exceptions. You're allowed to look at a map.
Right.
So anyway, the idea, but
I know one thing that's been effective, you know, is personally was seeing some of the real life examples of individuals that, or the reenactments, I would say, of individuals that sent a text and got into a horrific accident that caused a fatality. And hearing those parents and those loved ones talk about, you know, just someone putting thank you or I'm on my way caused them to, you know, caused them to lose their life. And some of those team victim impact panels that I talked about shows a lot of those indirect reenactments very graphically, and those are very impactful.
Yeah, you know, let me make a quick point. It's really good. If, when I was in the Army, if you were killed and not wearing your seatbelt, your life insurance wasn't good. Maybe you ought to have somewhere, if you're texting or driving and you kill yourself or other people, your life insurance is not going to be any good. That might be a good deterrent there to put it, say, so look, if you get killed texting or driving, you'll get
the life insurance. Well, yeah.
Kids are immortal.
Where'd that come up? Something similar to that, but get to the crevices of my mind here. Well, insurance policies can exclude coverage if you're killed and impaired.
Yep.
Georgia has that law on the books.
Yep.
Now, Virginia ignored that law on the books. Many states have gotten rid of those laws, and at the time I advocated for our state repealing that law, because what it did is it resulted in the hospitals and others not testing that deceased person to determine what the heck was going on with them for fear that if they do test them, then the family's not going to get the money. So while it, you would think, has a deterrent effect,
yeah,
it doesn't.
Yeah.
And so the question is, if the law in the book doesn't change behavior for the good, then why do we have that law in the books? So kind of a convoluted way to get to your question, fair point. And it was intended at the time to try to get all of us not to drink and drive.
Yeah.
So if that answers the question in the texting environment, then okay, you know, that may be, you know, a way. I mean, I could sit here and suggest that the way to address texting is as we've addressed safety belts, occupant protection, and impaired driving. For a long time, the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration in many states has simply said, don't drink and drive, you know, ride alive, drive well, you know, do these great things. And you know, most of us are thinking people do. But if you want to get to the risk taker, the person who doesn't believe that they're that person that's going to get killed that day, if they engage in this behavior, then something else is needed. Well, understand, if you don't believe you're going to get killed that day in the car, you're going to do whatever you want, right?
Yeah.
Right.
I mean, most of us are logical in that way. Even if you're a high risk taker, you don't think you're going to die from that effort, even though data says you might at a higher level. So what happens is the model is to say that, well, we know you don't think you're going to get hurt, but if we can make you think you're going to get a ticket, then you might change your behavior. And the fact of the matter is, data has consistently shown this, that with a little bit of enforcement, a lot of talking about the enforcement, then people generally change their behavior. So what we saw for safety belts, for example, is when they were first implemented, like in 69, you know, eventually we got about half the people using them. But now to get into the 90s, you have to have that enforcement model. Exactly the same thing is true with impaired driving. If you don't enforce the impaired driving laws, people, you know, bad risk takers will do those things. So the question is, how do we get there? And you've heard me say this before. How many texting citations are there a year in the state of Georgia?
Not very many.
Less than 5,000.
Yeah.
Right?
It's hard to detect. You can see that a person doesn't have a seatbelt on. But you can't, I mean, a lot of people are very crafty about how they're texting. I mean,
can't you check cell phone records or whatever, that kind of thing?
Well, that's probably still an evolving question as to what your probable cause is to be able to look at records without a court order. But to the point of yeah, it is hard to detect. But the same argument was made about impaired driving. And remember, when safety belts were first implemented, you didn't have this. It was only later that you had the harness, because they called it that three-point safety belt. So if you want to get to a higher degree of compliance, in my opinion, with texting, then you had to enforce it. By the way, 90% of those come from Gwinnett County. Out of those, most of them come from two officers. So I'm telling you, it's not important. Now, therefore, do you guys see people texting on driving all the time?
Well, the police go out and do it. They used to go out and get those kind of drivers.
It's hard. It takes a concerted effort in a program. You have to do a lot of things to get to that point, and you have to talk about it. Because if you're the offender, they don't usually go back to the office and say, you know what, I'm the idiot that just got to take it to the next one.
It would seem to me that some kind of a public safety message on television, you know, 30-second spot or something like that would be helpful for drivers. Does any state have some kind of public service message that they put on television for simple things, you know, move over to the right when you're going slower than traffic or change
your
lanes?
Come on, Dale, you're meddling now. You're meddling, make people move over to the right.
Or using your signal to change lanes and these kind of things.
Oh my gosh.
Nothing really big.
We don't do that, do we? I'll give you an anecdote on I'll answer your question, and the answer is yes, and I'll get to what of it. Mercedes-Benz, as you know, has moved to Dunwoody temporarily until its headquarters is built in Sandy Springs. So I live in Dunwoody, and I drive that segment where their headquarters is now at least twice a day. And I started noticing people using their signal when they were never using before. Because I look at this stuff, I mentioned. And then I started realizing these were Mercedes-Benz that were doing it. And then I saw they all had manufacturer's tags. Oh, these are Germans. They're about, they use their stuff, right? You know, in contrast to the rest of us, because they is us when it comes to this kind of thing. On the idea of the messaging that you're talking about, for example, the governor put together, I thought, a pretty good ad that was aired that talked about texting and talked about excessive speed and talked about impaired driving. Three messages, kind of hard to mix, but they did a pretty good job with it. Let me just say this, when those ads are placed, they're not placed to get to you guys. I hate to say this, that you're not the target audience. That's a good thing. They get placed in those locations of viewers, like Comedy Central, some of the sports stuff, things that you don't necessarily watch.
Jerry Springer shows.
Yes, of course, my favorite. They get placed in those areas, but you have limited ad dollars. So you're not gonna give it to everybody. You try to target the audience that you think is overrepresented, so you get more bang for your buck. So if that helps answer the question.
Okay, so they're out there is what you're saying.
Yes, but here's the point. Your messaging, in my opinion, also needs to include the enforcement part of it. And the problem is, you look at the things that cause crash deaths. Unfortunately, you're not gonna get to blinkers. You're not gonna get to improper lane change, which does cause a lot of problems. You're not gonna get to following too close. The move over law, there are a lot of signs fixed, and you'll see that on a variable message board, over the interstate. They talk about that pretty regularly. When that law was put in place, nobody knew about it, and there was a concerted effort to try to earn media, get the fixed signs and the terrible message signs, but the office did not have the money to get the message out there in any meaningful way. But a very good point. I'm sorry, any other kinds of questions? Yes, Ryan.
Maybe I missed this, but are the penalties the same if I caused an accident while texting or using a cell phone versus not doing it? I have chosen to do something that, in my view, is a little dangerous,
right,
by texting or using a cell phone while driving.
I have not seen accidents where the underlying cause was texting. Usually the ticket is just texting while driving. There was no accident. It was just texting while driving. Or I'll see an accident, but as far as the underlying, I won't know exactly what that underlying reason was for the following ticket. So I haven't seen the two together. No one's alleged that their cause was for texting.
It's a little bit like choosing to have a drink or two.
Right, it is.
I'm
it
choosing
is,
to do something
similar.
That's considered to be unsafe.
Do you use go phone cameras as defense in court? Is that become more prevalent? GoPro cameras.
People are putting
dash cameras.
Is that admissible as evidence or to prove your point or case or something?
You know, I had one trial where a person had a dash cam and it was the clearest picture. I admitted it. It came in and it was very clear. I hadn't seen it before. I had had seen it, of course, as a prosecutor. I had seen it through the officer's vehicle, but those dash cams are very clear, and I admitted the evidence in that case.
Yes. Roll on camera, smile. And drive safe, right? Well, get Judge ahead. I know you work for BRC. Thank you. In an area that's actually very well qualified with their prosecutorial background. So congratulations to you, and As we all know, when we look at the ballot, it's going to be mostly judges on there because DeKalb County has a new court with four judges, and many of the judges are up for re-election in most instances. And some will have opposition. We also have our DA and solicitor. Both races have contested races. So there's going to be a pretty significant ballot for DeKalb County because of all the judiciary races. Get involved. Wait, we got the Senate race. And on that note, let me switch gears. We have the Lincoln Day dinner coming up. And we are in the process of getting Senator Johnny Isaacs in there. We have not gotten the yes for sure yet, but I'm very hopeful. So the answer
everybody
is.
Everybody come, or you going to exclude anybody?
Well, if anybody who wants to behave can come.
Anybody with $50.
Right.
Not even a homeless person.
Yeah. Well, the idea is for this, we're going to talk a little bit about Paul Jennings. You recall that Senator Tysinger passed away. We talked about Senator Tysinger, Loretta Tysinger was there. And just a little bit about lifting up the service that they gave to us. We're going to do the same thing with Paul. We'll let the folks know that he was part and parcel of this group, but of a much bigger group of representatives who worked for the citizens here. And, you know the story.
He worked for some
citizens. That's another matter of interpretation.
Because he's the one that didn't let me go in the last.
Paul Jennings?
Yeah.
So we'll have that coming up. So I don't know if you have anything more to add to that.
The thing I have to add is the flyers on the desk on your tables, and everything on there is accurate, including the menu that we're going to have, which is very good.
Yeah, food there is really good.
I have now have tickets. So.
By the way, anybody have any other things they want to contribute? We got a couple minutes here.
I'm moving to adjourn.
You're going off. Brian, do you have any announcements? Tammy, do you have any announcements?
I'll defer to Travis for the DeKalb GOP. He's an officer.
Yeah.
Anything
to Travis is the first class chair.
Travis, you got a little press this week.
Well, we're trying our best to make things right. I'll put it to you that way. Couple of updates. We should, in the near future, we've already secured our location at Lakeside again for the mass meetings. Thank you so much. It will be at Lakeside again. Exactly. So if you haven't updated your email address, we just ask that you please update your email address, because one of my main things is making sure that people get all of the information and everything that they need to be open, honest, hoo-ha. So please update any information. And if you have any questions regarding anything that's going on, don't hesitate to email me or call me. I promise I'll get back with you. I'll let you know exactly what's going on. And if you have some complaints, let me know that too. Not too many, but I'll take what you got.
The past precinct meetings are the first step.
February.
And then the county convention of the Republican Party is on the 19th of March.
Yeah.
And then the state convention is in May, and then of course we have national convention in
July.
Wow. Get away with Donald Trump shirt.
Well, there you go. Was it? You have an you have a meeting after this?
Well, we have a board meeting here, and then we have one at the library at 10:30. Anybody's welcome to come. After today, we're moving over to the DeKalb GOP office for our Saturday meetings. You know, any of you that would like to be associate members, it's only $20. Mary Solchus over there is our new president. I have stepped down to the lovely position of first vice president. Yay, less work. Anyway.
And for our next meeting in February, we are going to have representatives from all of the presidential campaigns to come. So if you have any friends that are undecided, that'll be a good opportunity to have people come and meet people who are actually representing the presidential campaigns. I thought that would be a good opportunity for us to get to get that.
That will be at the DeKalb GOP office at
1:00. There, the flyers on your tables, if you're not going to use these to order tickets, give them to someone you think may be interested. And also, the last thing I want to say is, because we don't want to be kicked out of here, be sure to take all your table stuff with you and put the chairs back in front of you.
Get out of home. Thank you all.